Everyone. Is everyone doing good today?
Yes.
Well, my name is Capri Orr, and I am the graduate assistant, one of the graduate assistants, in the Department of Africology and African American Studies. I would like to welcome everyone here. We are glad to see you, okay? I have the honor and the privilege to introducing our department head of Africology and African American Studies. So if you could please help me welcome Dr. Victor Oguejiofor.
Non-partisan and expert panel evaluation of Barack Obama's presidency. This department has been running this annual panel discussion since the inception of Obama's presidency. As all of us gathered here today would most probably agree, Obama's emergence and re-election as President of the United States represented watershed moments in not only African American history, but also in American and global histories of humanity in general. Thus, those watershed moments ought to be recounted during this month of February of each year that this nation has come to embrace as a special period of sculpting, a time for recounting the trials and challenges of African American life and culture in this society. Designed as a critical examination of Obama's presidency to help pack the Black History Month, each edition of this evaluative process has been vigorous and reasonably balanced. Today's promises to be no different from the previous editions, given the makeup of the panel and the topic of this discussion. I must emphasize that although I will pose most of the questions for the panel, later on, members of the audience will be given the chance to ask their own questions. As you have must have noticed, we have provided refreshments for you. Please feel free to get up and help yourself to the refreshments as the program moves on. Students, please be sure to complete and return the LDC credit form to the information table. At this time, I would like you to join me in inviting the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, Professor Thomas Venner, to say some words of welcome. After him, our Provost and Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs, Professor Kim Schatzel, will also share some greetings with us. In addition, she will introduce the panelists. Ladies and gentlemen,
thank you, Victor, and welcome everyone to this very important discussion. As Dr. Okafor mentioned, this is the latest in a series of events related to the presidency of Barack Obama, covering matters of diversity, politics, and other issues important to us as an academic community and as citizens of the Black community. Nation, and as dean of this college, I'm very proud of this particular effort. Like many of you, I'm sure, I listened intently to the President's State of the Union address about a week ago. One of the issues I wanted to hear him speak about, or at least touch on, was that of the so-called political gridlock, that spectacular display of political intransigence that we've been watching in Washington now for several years. His speech actually made several references to it. To encourage Congress to break with this state of gridlock, the President used a variety of rhetorical devices. He cajoled, he used humor, he reached out to members of Congress, and he even threatened, when necessary, to just go it alone and entirely act on his own in order to get the work of the people done. Finally, at the end of the speech, he used a rhetorical device, I guess you could call it. It was extremely effective, I thought. He had us direct our attention to a soldier named Corey Remsburg, who was struggling to recover from horrible injury he received from a roadside bomb in Afghanistan. The president's point was unmistakable. As a nation, we have problems, and they seem insurmountable, but they can be overcome. If Sergeant Rensper can do it, so can we. I want to commend and express my appreciation to the faculty of the Department of Anthropology and African American Studies, its head, Dr. Victor Okafor, for putting this event together, our panel of distinguished scholars, and to each of you in the room today for your interest and participation in this important conversation.
Seriousness as well as the importance of the conversation that will go on today. It's just a pleasure to be part of it. It's a pleasure that we host this event, and we very much thank the leadership that you've shown in terms of being able to have this event for us. It's my great pleasure, and introducing people is one of the things that Provost often has to do because of the fact that it provides an opportunity for us to recognize the talent of the scholars and the work of the scholars that are going to be with us today. So with that, I'll begin, and again, it's my great pleasure to do this. I'll begin by introducing Dr. Betty Brown-Chappell, who's the author of Open Secrets, A Poor Person's Life in Higher Education. She was named by Eastern Michigan University as a 2012 Martin Luther King Humanitarian Award recipient. We talked about the fact that she is also a recently retired professor in the School of Social Work, where she taught courses in social welfare policy and gerontology. While she was at Eastern, she also served as the Associate Director of our Honors College and McNair's Scholars Program. At the end of the panel here is Dr. Lisa Cerroni-Long. She is a guest of ours and is a cultural and applied anthropologist. Her major interests include anthropological theories and methods, as well as intercultural relations and ethnicity. Before receiving her PhD in anthropology from UCLA, she trained academically in Italy, receiving a doctorate of literature from the Oriental Institute of the University of Venice, as well as in Japan, where she completed a postdoctoral study in comparative civilizations. She's done much field work in terms of looking at these questions in Asia, Europe, and America, and has taught in Italy, Japan, Austria, as well as Slovenia. Also, one of the things that she's been involved in is UNESCO, where she's engaged in a cross-cultural study of multicultural education, and we're most pleased to have Dr. Cerroni-Long join our panel. Dr. Patrick Pieh is a long-standing part of our Department of Africology and American Studies here at Eastern, has made much contribution as an instructor. He has over 35 years of experience in academic administration, teaching, program development, for student retention, has been involved in West Africa, Colorado, and Michigan, as well as Liberia, and has found time to do an important piece of volunteer work for the Youth for Understanding, which prepares young people for the responsibilities of the changing, as well as interdependent group, and we welcome him as well. Dr. Sherry Johnson is an assistant professor of English and African American Studies at Grand Valley, where she coordinates the African and African American Studies program, and is also an assistant professor in the English department. Her scholarly interests include Black Canadian writing and its effect on Canadian multiculturalism, contemporary African American, as well as women's literature and discussion about the border between academics and public scholarship, and we welcome her. Dr. Solange Simões is an associate professor of women and gender studies. She holds a PhD in sociology from the University of London, England. She also holds an MA in political science, as well as a BA in social sciences. Her interests are engaging in international comparative research on issues of gender, race, class, and the global environment, and has a special interest in women and globalizations, transnational feminism, and gender and work. And finally, but not last, is Dr. Ravi K Perry, who holds a BA from University of Michigan and an MA and PhD from Brown, each of which are in political science. He is a scholar that is doing work with regard to the prolific issues that are facing African Americans in the United States. He specializes in looking at Black politics, minority representation, and urban politics. He is an assistant professor of political science and a Stennis Scholar for Municipal Government at Mississippi State University. His activism and commentary on RJ is often found in national media outlets. And we welcome all of these panelists, and we're so pleased to have this distinguished panel with us today. I know you all join me in giving them a warm welcome and a round of applause.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Provost Schatzel. It's time now for the main event. And as already arranged, the way we're going to conduct the discussion is as follows. Each panelist will offer a 3-minute opening statement about his or her take on Barack Obama's overall performance so far as a second-term president. Thereafter, I, as the moderator, will pose a few questions that the panelists will answer and then cross-talk about. Once a question is posed, any panelist can respond to it, and other panelists can follow suit one after another. Take note that members of the audience will have a chance to ask questions of their own, one person at a time, after my own round of questions. That part of it will be conducted by Professor Woods. I'll go ahead with the first question. I'll invite you to make your opening statements in any order. Go ahead. Go ahead. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
All right. What I want to do is just provide an overarching context to our thinking and our discussion. For the 17 years that I worked at Eastern, I drew on my research on Black leadership, and particularly Black mayors in those years teaching social welfare policy. And so I have to say that my take on the president's overall performance is that he's been asked to spin straw into gold. And by this I mean that, like all presidents, he is constitutionally responsible for executing the policies passed by our representatives. That would be our House and our Senate. However, since 1980, the last 30 years, our national population has increased by almost 25%, but there are now 35,000 less federal employees to serve this population. He's trying to do more for more people with less staff. That's what that boils down to. Additionally, the military employees have decreased from 2 million, according to the Office of Personnel Management in 1980, to 1.55 million. We have a roughly $3.84 trillion budget. One could ask, however, if it is kept pace with inflation. While our deficit, no one really has been emphasizing this, has been decreasing as the economy has begun to climb out of the Great Recession, we also note, as on Monday's article in the New York Times, that the middle class is shrinking. The rich have gotten much richer, and the middle class have become the lower class. I've been responsible for program implementation of federal programs while I worked for the city of Detroit, and that's how I got interested in Black leadership. One of my findings was that presidents, mayors, and governors provide symbolic leadership, and they also can yield tangible outcomes for our basic needs. And so the key point that I want to make is that we have to be able to separate that which is tangible, like housing, transportation, clothing, food, from that which is intangible, which is a great speech by a great guy. Additionally, as former Mayor Coleman Young once told me, he said, "Look, Betty, no one gives power. You take it. There are no promises of power." President Obama has said much the same thing. He said to us many times when I was at the inaugural ball, I remember hearing this, not this inaugural, but the previous one, you have to do your work, the voters, if you expect me to deliver for you. I need to hear from you. I need to see you.
Thank you very much.
Can I
Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so when Professor Okafor invited me to participate in this panel, I felt I could only make a limited contribution by speaking about the evolution of international public opinions and perceptions of the Obama government, and also make a few remarks about Obama's records on gender equality. I spent last fall on a sabbatical leave in Brazil and could not closely follow the news and analysis, especially during that crucial month of October. But as we know, when Obama was elected president in 2008, there was a tremendous amount of world support and expectations in relation to his presidency. Among the factors leading to very high levels of international support, I would like to highlight two. Obama's election as the first African-American U.S. president, representing a victory against racism and centuries of exclusion of minorities, and related to that, a possibility, after Bush, of the U.S. being also more inclusive of other peoples of the world, a more cooperative, a more trusted partner in international relations. The question I'd like to raise and explore is, here is, what has been the evolution of international perceptions of the Obama government and of the U.S. under the Obama administrations? How could we interpret the changes in world public perceptions? In fact, cross-national studies conducted by the Pieh Research Center show a still relatively high, in relation to Bush, for instance, but decreasing rates of approval of Obama in the second term. This is related to the international mass public's perceptions that the U.S. does not consider other countries' interests. In fact, there is a widespread international perception that the U.S. does not listen to other countries. Well, the NSA may beg to differ. listening, right? What is the difference after all? But around the world, many believe the U.S. acts in its own self-interest in global affairs, ignoring other countries. For their part, Americans see this issue quite differently. 70% say their country does take into account the interests of other nations when it is making decisions about foreign policy. I would like to note that this data from mid-2013 does not address the controversies over U.S. surveillance programs released after Snowden's leaking of NSA documents. But I would like to illustrate these controversies with the Brazilian case, which I followed while in Brazil last fall. The Guardian journalist that Snowden gave the NSA documents to, Greenwald, resides in Rio de Janeiro and wrote extensively about the NSA spying of millions of Brazilians' public email messages, communications from the Brazilian Petroleum Agency, and private calls of Brazil's President Dilma Rousseff. In fact, she had a state visit to the U.S. scheduled for October, but she canceled it when Obama failed to issue a public apology. She demanded that, he didn't. Canceling a state visit is quite unprecedented, but the media coverage and the Brazilian public outrage probably weighed heavily on Dilma's decisions. So how could we interpret the findings showing that international public opinion on Obama has been shifting so much? I would like to suggest that despite the world's hope for more inclusive foreign relations, the U.S. under the second Obama administration is not perceived as having broken away from the ideology of American exceptionalism and the practice of American exceptionalism. What do I mean by that? By American exceptionalism, I mean the U.S. not fully participating in the international community by, for instance, not signing or ratifying important international treaties and conventions, such as the Kyoto Protocol on Climate Change, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and CEDAW, which is the International Women's Bill of Rights. But I have to say, Obama's administration has made some moves in those directions, of the Environmental Treaty, for instance, and the Women's Bill of Rights, although this has not yet been ratified. Turning to American exceptionalism, despite U.S. higher levels of income and wealth inequality that Dr. Barry Brown just mentioned, compared to other developed nations,
fewer prospects for class mobility, lack of universal health care, and other social welfare policies and safety nets for working families in America, Obama repeated in his many speeches, chooses to refer to the U.S. just as the greatest nation on earth. I would like to conclude by suggesting that minorities in America would more likely benefit from a more critical view in action to address social policies and social inequalities, and by a willingness to look up to other nations' achievements in social policies and commitment to international treaties. And I use my minutes. When I have an opportunity, I'd like to talk a little bit about gender equality.
Good morning. I accepted this assignment with real deep emotion for two reasons. One, as a young, like any parent, we all become very impressed with our children. 2 years ago, my son called me. He was working for a law firm in Milwaukee. And he said, Daddy, I'm going to resign and take up the position as the to run the president's re-election campaign in Minneapolis for almost less than what he was making as a lawyer. And I asked him, son, well, if that is your decision, I support you. He did that, and today he works directly as the White House liaison between the EPA and the White House. And so I talked with him. So I when I know this topic, I ask myself, having lived in America for almost the last 20 years plus, what do I want to bring out? How do we evaluate? Evaluating people is not as easy as you giving an exam to students. Because you've already given them a course outline. And you evaluate them based on what you said. But rather than speaking generally, I thought I wanted to bring out some basic American history. History that sometimes is lost. Because if you go back in the old tradition of African political system, the late Nyerere used to say, in the olden days, old men sat under the palm tree and made decisions. Today we go to panel and we debate issues and we forget about history. So what I want to do is basically start my remark by quoting Thomas Jefferson when he said, governments are instituted among men driving their powers from the concern, they're driving their power from the consentment of the governed. This is something that was said during the development of the Declaration of Independence. In all of these things, between July 4th, 1776 and 1778, all that was really embodied in this document is that all men have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. This principle was formalized in 1978 with the ratification of the United States Constitution. The document is the supreme law of the U.S., the foundation of the federal government that allowed different states to all come together and to act together as one while protecting the interests of individual states. Given this sort of background, one of the assurances was to ensure that no person or no one group would amass too much power. The founders therefore established a government in which the powers to create, implement, and adjudicate laws were separate with different divisions. One of the things I always want to remind people, when this documentation was made, even though you had a division of power, but you did not have a cluster of wealthy men who could influence decisions. When this, when the declaration was made, the population of the United States was, technically speaking, 100% or maybe 88, 90% is white, even though the Indians were there. In retrospect, when you look at the population of Latin America today in the 21st century, that number has changed. So that given all of these facts, when asked upon to evaluate the president, I ask two questions. Leadership is such an important element, but if leaders are not accepted, or if leaders are not taken for what they are supposed to provide, because remember, in the Constitution, yes, the president can veto, the legislature can propose issues, but it begins to remind people the very night when Obama was being, or President Obama was being inaugurated, a group of folks sat somewhere plotting. We want to make sure he does not succeed. One of the realities in discussing the evaluation of Obama is the fact that we've never been able to discuss, strictly speaking, the notion of ethnicity and political development in this country. How many presidents, at least I lived in America as an undergraduate student in 1965 all the way down, I had never seen any president giving a speech being told, you are a liar. And what is sad sometimes is that even the media or the academic institutions, we have not taken on the challenge to say that is not what is expected if we will have a leadership role. Because we've never taken these challenges, ladies and gentlemen. When Obama inherited, he had one agreement, one major focus, and that is the president's central focus is to stimulate not just the economic recovery, but to help America emerge from whatever the challenges they've had over the last 40 years, so that it becomes a prosperous nation. The current economic crisis did not occur 5 years ago. That's why sometimes bothers me when people are sued, where the unemployment is high. Well, the man has only been president for 4 or 5 years. Even investment, if you take $10 and invest in the bank, it's going to take more than 5 years for you to realize anything. So that when we begin to look at these things, we want to look at the other thing I want to bring begin to for us to consider as we begin to evaluate. Let's go back. I guess I listed a couple slogans that they used in the State of the Union yesterday. In 2011, his focus was win the future. In 2012, he said build to last. In 2013, let's get it done. And this year, it talks about a year of reaction. When he made the statement, if the Senate cannot come along, or the House cannot come along, I will use the pen. He was immediately decried as somebody who wants to be a dictator. We all know his world history. But people forgot that in American history, there is a compromise, a word that has become a deadly word today. The last statement I want to make here, ladies and gentlemen, is the fact that in our ability to discuss this issue, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think I've run out of time. I was just warming up. I'll wait for my next action. Thank you.
My area of interest and expertise is education policy and the idea of employing market strategies in the public arena to see how that would work out. I am an impromptu speaker, so I speak from the cuff, so I hope that's okay. I will be very brief in my comments. As we begin to discuss the president's second term in office, gridlock is an understatement as we look at some of the things that are going on. With the Republican Party itself, I think there has to be a discussion there because the party is changing, or the landscape of the party is changing, and there's disagreement inside the party in the direction. As a result of which, with the president, it becomes very difficult when you attempt to compromise. However, there has to be a discussion about the president's leadership style, how he will be remembered by history, his character, his approach to compromise. Also, the elephant in the room that I think we'll talk about today is Obamacare and the healthcare reform bill. And then how do you, for me as I talk to young people across the university, how do you get young people to buy into it? How do you get people across the country just to understand and figure out what it is or what's going on so that they're not afraid of it? And as we get back to, I guess, his domestic policy agenda, how does he move forward in a situation to whereby healthcare does not dominate his entire administration? So some of the other issues that were important to him, such as immigration reform, or same-sex rights, or crime policy, or education policy, he does not or he should not allow those things to become lost. So he has to find a way to bring those things back into focus and to draw the American public in. And as I listen to people speak, I wrote down on my page, hope and change. When Barack Obama came into office, he was very young, very energetic, and a lot of people bought into the dream that he sold. One of the things that he has to do in this second term is to begin to pull people back in and to sell that dream. Because across the country, people are becoming disillusioned with the president as well as Congress. And if we look at his State of the Union address last week, the viewership was relatively low. And I think it is people across the country, they would like to send a message to Congress in general and the president as well. They're tired of the infighting, and at some point you have to begin to find a compromise and a solution to the problem. So I hope we'll talk about some of the domestic issues as the panel goes on. Thank you.
Thank you. I welcome you, and I need to apologize. I will have to leave in about 20 minutes, so I won't be able to stay for a lot of the questions, which I regret. But I was really pleased to be on this panel again, because I think I was on perhaps the first of these meetings that we have recurrently over the years about judging the performance of President Obama as a president, as a leader, as a unifier of the country at the time when, let us remember, the country has been at war for a long time. And many people don't realize that perhaps the strategies that President Obama has put in place to get American soldiers home and to close up the war experiments that this country has been involved with for a very long time is one of the major achievements of his leadership. As an anthropologist, though, I want to look at his role as a president from a comparative and a contextual point of view. One of my specialties is the study of American culture and American ethnicity within American cultural context. And in that respect, I often go back to rereading the book that President Obama wrote before actually becoming president, which is a sort of memoir and analysis of his growing up as a biracial child in the United States. It's a fascinating and very well written book, as it provides insights about the experience of ethnicity, particularly of black ethnicity in the United States. So given those premises, I wanted to summarize what I think have been the achievements of this last second term, which was the commitment that I gave for my presentation, to 3 points. First of all, I think that President Obama has demonstrated of being patriotic without being ethnocentric. That is a very major achievement. And I think that his background is probably one of the causes for this real attention that he gives to cultural differences. And the way he translates that into the value he gives to diplomacy over militaristic intervention in solving problems with other countries. I think that the way he handled the growing frenzy
for intervention, militaristic intervention in Syria, has been tremendous and has been subtle, and most people haven't really even noticed the ability, the strategic ability that he has put into place in dealing with this issue in a way that deflected from the kind of rising enthusiasm, I have to say, towards another military intervention. So that is a very, very important point of his leadership that I think particularly foreigners can appreciate more than even Americans, because from the foreign point of view, very often the United States has been seen as this Western leader that is sometimes, too self-contained in its own interests to really give credit to the interests of other countries and other cultures. The second achievement, I think, is that he's a realist without being timid. And in that respect, I particularly want to emphasize the incredible achievement of introducing the Affordable Care Act, which has been plagued by resistance from all sides. You may remember that it went all the way to the Supreme Court, this was implemented in a way that will have long-term effects on the entire population of the United States, and actually brings the United States on par with other Western societies that have had this kind of system for a very long time, and sometimes looked at the United States with horror in terms of the kind of services that the government should provide in an industrialized, advanced society. However, at the same time, he's also very, very cognizant of the fact that capitalist economy is at the core of American society. And so he has been criticized for giving more attention to Wall Street than Main Street. Well, he had to compromise. He knew that he could not antagonize big business, and he was even willing to put some government support behind the recovery of, for example, the automotive industry, which has recovered without necessarily bringing about a lot of increase in employment, but has recovered in terms of being a big player in the capitalistic system that is at the core of this society. So he's a realist, and he should not be accused of being too timid, because he has not been timid, but he has been strategically minded about what to give priorities to. The third thing that I wanted to highlight is, again, something that many people have not really talked about, but because it's subtle. But it has had an impact on the educational system by reorganizing the focus of federal support for students and education in ways that have subtly taken away the focus of assessment from content, which was the legacy of the Reagan years. And I've been here in this country for a long time and in education for a long time, so I know that a lot of the assessment of content has been inherited from the policies instituted by the President Reagan and by some of his associates and advisors, such as, for example, Lynn Cheney, and people of that kind that were really focused on controlling the content of education, rather than, as Obama is encouraging us to look at, into focusing into the application of education into the workforce. So I think that this is another major achievement which he has just put the foundations for, but might have a very long-term, extremely relevant result. And I'm closing it.
Okay.
Okay, thank you so much for inviting me back.
You need the mic.
Oh, to you. Is this better? Better? Yeah, okay. Thanks so much. I want to echo what some of my esteemed colleagues have said already, in that evaluating President Obama's performance is something that would be very complicated, and I'm not sure that it's something that I'm willing to do in terms of saying he's doing well, he's doing poorly, he's that. I'm not going to be able to make that kind of evaluation. But what I do want to talk about, or what I want us to think about as we are evaluating or discussing, critically discussing his performance thus far, is the to consider the various cultures that he is a part of, because that determines the way in which we, or affects the way in which we evaluate him. So, for instance, as somebody who identifies as an African American, the history behind the election of an African American as a president certainly would affect the lens through which one evaluates him, right? Can do no wrong. He's achieved a certain status that certainly is difficult for many people who have tried before him. Right? So if we look at it in terms of racial culture and that history within this nation, that's one way that we can evaluate him. The other would be as a politician, which President Obama is through and through. And I think he's certainly talented in his rhetoric and how he brings things to people and diplomacy and things like that. I think that's one way in which we can evaluate him. The thing is that they're so different. The histories of those two things are so different. And sometimes one might think even antithetical, given the history of politics in this nation with regards to African Americans. That alone demonstrates the tensions and the difficulties of trying to evaluate him. And I guess I could use one example, which I'm sure we'll have plenty as we go along, which is the one that Dr. Pieh highlighted when he reminded us of that State of the Union when somebody called out, "You're a liar." Okay? That can be read in so many different ways, right? And there's no way that you can divorce race from that. Ironically, it's not, so he's been successful in making it appear as though the policies that he's making are devoid of any kind of racial background, if I don't know how else to say that. Right? Yet still he is certainly read in that. The last thing I want to say is I want to kind of think about whether it'd be possible, just kind of riffing off of Dr. Patrick, that where she says that he, one of the things he has to do this in this last few years is to think about ways to sell the dream. Resell the dream? I don't know. I don't know, but we have to think about that, and I guess the question I want us to think about is whether that would be possible. People now are, I feel like the honeymoon is over, and people can gauge his performance and or who he is based upon their lived experiences in the nation under his presidency and the policies that he's done, even though the ramifications of those we'll see probably much later years. And also, not only can they gauge from their own experiences, but they can also gauge from the way in which he is treated in this nation as the leader. So it would be difficult for him to sell the dream because there is such pushback against President Obama, and you cannot deny that that pushback has to do with his race. Okay, so I think that's where I'll I'd love to discuss these things as we move forward.
Hi, I'm glad to be here. I'll do a quick plug, and I'm not ashamed. I just wrote a book, and so if you want to buy it, please do. It's about a lot of stuff we're talking about today. It's called Black Mayors, White Majorities, published by the University of Nebraska Press. In it, I author a theory as a political scientist that talks about how politicians like the president, whom we're talking about today, has been able to successfully get white voters on his or her side by convincing whites that what's in the interest of people of color is in the interest of the broader community as well. He's done that very successfully. No other president prior to him has done so. From a political science point of view, we've always argued that politicians in general are either racialized or they're deracialized, meaning they either explicitly reference race in the articulation of public policy programs for subsections of the population, or they're deracialized in that they try to de-emphasize the significance of race. We are a racial country. America created race. We know that in this department, Africology, African American Studies. If you don't know that, take some classes in the department. You can figure that out. So racial language is very powerful. We all met, we should be celebrating the 10th anniversary. We all met President Obama for the most part, most of us did 10 years ago, 2004, in Boston, Massachusetts. On the platform of the Democratic National Convention, in which he was articulating his values of the country as a new freshman senator, fresh out of winning in Illinois, a victory that no one predicted that he would win, in large part because two of his primary Democratic challengers had to resign due to foibles in their campaigns, right? So he was a fluke, and he talked about that in his own book, that his own election was a fluke. And had he not won that election, we wouldn't be talking about him today. So that's one thing that we should know. We've really known this man for about 10 years, most of us. About evaluation, I'll say that most of us, not in this room, but as Americans, really don't have a right to evaluate him. Because most of us didn't vote in 2008 or in the prior re-election. So you really don't have the opportunity to really evaluate politicians you actually participated in the democratic systems. For those of us who did, I think we have not really an opportunity to evaluate, but I would rather play with nomenclature and say assess, and be able to assess exactly what has or what has not happened respective to what his agenda was. When we met him in 2004, he said that, I'm paraphrasing, you know, this is not a white America, black America, this is not a red America or a blue America, this is the United States of America. We all bought into that rhetoric. We were excited by it. Remember, this is the Bush era, right? And I won't go into those details. So, you know, to hear a president a candidate who we thought could be a president at some point, echo those words, we immediately thought, oh my gosh, this is amazing, right? And we were all kind of reinvigorated into what politicians can do and mean for us. And we were excited by that. Lo and behold, he ends up running for president, which he himself did not think that he would win. And he had success in Iowa, success in South Carolina, beat the now, soon to be, next Democratic candidate, Hillary Clinton, and the rest is history, right? But Obama's back, y'all, so I don't know if y'all paid attention. The reason why we know Obama's back, you know, he rolled in on the election on the hope and change rhetoric, right? I would disagree with some of my colleagues on this panel. Rhetoric is powerful. Rhetoric is everything. Rhetoric is what gets us in the room to actually care about what a politician has to say. And then, as a result of the rhetoric, we assess whether or not we agree with that politician's policies. But if it's not for rhetoric, then we have no idea who these people are. We are not introduced to them in any substantive way. And so the rhetoric is important. The fact that he's been able to successfully at least introduce to people the reality of slavery and injustice in the society, of second-class citizenship for certain groups of people, including members of person of color communities, but also the LGBT communities as well, that is, you know, a unique platform that a president has always had, but has really never utilized, and this president has done so. And the fact that we can hear it now, he's really given license to every future president to explicitly talk about the needs of the disadvantaged and the marginalized in a way that is not a separatist or that encourages people to acknowledge their divisions, but as he talks about on Diversity of Hope, to encourage all of us to be cognizant of our shared understandings. Last thing I'll say is that I hope that we can talk about The changes in the second term respective to administrative policies, executive orders, things that have occurred in the internal workings of the White House memo system versus that which has actually become law or that which has occurred through court order. The reason is because we know that longevity and sustainability of the public policy initiatives tend to be more likely in the event that we can ensure that those are legislative priorities that get passed in the congressional system. And so hopefully we can talk about that. But he's back, and here's why I think that his hope and change rhetoric is back, and he is going to resell the dream for us, and we are all going to buy into it. He ended his State of the Union speech by not saying just, you know, the typical presidential speech, oh, God bless America, right? We hear that billion times at the end of every presidential speech. His last two words were believe it. Mm-hmm. Believe it. This is the Barack Obama vote. And I can assure you that we'll, those of us who are disillusioned will be probably back singing his praises in a year or two.
Thank you very much for your opening statement. And thank you for your initial assessment of Obama's presidency. I want to move your attention to the relations between the White House and Congress. No doubt Obama's first term was marked by a somewhat difficult relationship with the Congress, although he was able to accomplish a lot, including the passage of the health care law when both the Senate and the House of Representatives were under a Democratic majority. in his first year as second term president, we've witnessed a federal government shutdown from October 1 to 16 last year. What is your future expectation regarding relations between the White House and the Congress, whose House of Representatives remains under Republican control?
I'll be brief. There will be no relationship. It's midterm season. So this really was the last presidential State of the Union address that's going to matter. This is the last substantive year that the president has to do anything serious. After midterms, the presidents are lame ducks, and what they say really doesn't matter. They start traveling foreign policy and doing handshakes and treaties and things like that. They have a lot of symbolic power, but not really a lot of substantive power. So if it doesn't get done in the next 6 months, I can assure you it's likely not going to get done. And you know, the election is going to take over the airwaves after June. So he's got about a 4 or 5 month window to get climate change, immigration, and a whole host of other things done, and the likelihood is that it's not going to happen.
Yes. I would argue, or I actually would agree with Dr. Perry, although I would like to return somewhat to the issue of healthcare, because first of all, we have handouts here available from the department on healthcare, and sure, they could be passed out. But for those of you who may be doing some research or would like to do some research or would like to know, oh, what difference does it make? I think these materials will allow you to come to your own conclusions. But particularly in this department, Africology and African American Studies, in the state that we are sitting in, 17% of African Americans do not have health care. We, in some ways, have dismissed or moved on from, and so I'm going to wrap it up. We have, in some ways, dismissed or moved on or assumed, well, okay, you got health care done. That's no, you know, it's over. It's not over because the Republican Party has consistently brought it back to the floor, and they will be introducing means to rescind it, to underfund it. I have had the opportunity to work under many presidents, I mean, as in administering at the city level, many of the federal programs, and I can tell you unequivocally, there is no program, I don't care how much propaganda comes through the airwaves, there is no federal program that I ever had to implement, and I've done several,
that the first 3 to 5 years, there wasn't a problem. The big difference was that there was bipartisan support to the extent that whether the president was Democratic or Republican, it was for the good of the country that we all got behind making the program better. This program has some flaws and some issues, but if I was to criticize President Obama at all, it would be for not campaigning as strongly as he might have done and may have to do in the future on this program, which will be, I believe, his signature achievement.
I think the president does have, Dr. Perry is right, with the midterm elections coming up, Democrats want the president to be very popular, and they want to be able to ride his coattails into office. They want to be able to ride his coattails into office, so it is important, his name is important, and what he's selling is important, and the constant bickering in Congress doesn't go away. I don't think we can talk about the gridlock in Congress without at least discussing the Republican Party and the breakdown that goes on, or that is going on there. And you brought up the shutdown. But the shutdown in Congress, if you guys remember watching Boehner on television, literally near tears, it was there's so much infighting inside of the party with different factions seeking to rise that the party can't come to an agreement. So if the party can't come to an agreement and healthcare doesn't go away and a lot of members of the party are still ticked off over healthcare or the healthcare bill and still fighting over it, the last 4 or 5 months that Dr. Perry has talked about will still be spent fighting. And we will still be, or they will still be talking about some of the same issues, the main one being healthcare, and it won't go away. And so other things will suffer and will be sacrificed. I'm very grateful.
And I guess, before I leave, answer, I'm going to recommend people, when you get home today, go on the web, type www.whitehouse.gov/issues. Go in there and look at all the president has attempted to do since he became president. One of the things I find so disturbing, when we want to evaluate people, when we don't even know what they've done. Number two, I agree with Dr. Perry. On the other hand, I would say no, it's not too late. One of the reasons why things changed so radically in 2012 was because folks stayed away. They didn't vote. We can even bring the same issues into Michigan. But if we can all get out of here and decide to participate, because one of the things that Jefferson said was the fact that the powers from the consent of the governed. Look at the last election. What was the percentage the president won? So we cannot afford to stay back. We have to be involved.
Next.
My response to the question about Congress and its relationship with Congress is simple. It's just going to continue to be as contentious. It's going to continue to be as contentious as always. I don't see that changing at all.
Yes, next. Does anybody else have anything else to say about that? Okay, well, let's move on. Now, while you were dealing with that question, you made references to the Affordable Care Act. So let me give you a chance to expound on that. What is your sense of how the presidency has implemented, has gone about the implementation of the Affordable Care Act, otherwise known as Obamacare? What's your take on that?
I think the president has done as good as he can in some ways. He's not going to fire Kathleen Sebelius, so those of you who want that, get over it. That's not going to happen. The rollout was a disaster. Everyone knows that, right? There's no way getting around that. If you're an Obama lover, sorry, it was a disaster. If you're you're an Obama hater, you're cheering, right? It was an absolute disaster, and it still is. And the result is not that it's just bad. The result is that that means fewer people that they predicted in their algorithms that would sign up have in fact signed up, mainly young people who they're banking on to really cover 60 to 80% of the new enrollees by the end of March. That has not happened, and it's not going to happen. But it's not going to happen for a host of reasons, and I'll mention two quick ones. One, the Affordable Care Act is a mandate, and if you don't have health insurance by March 31st, you will be fined on your next year's taxes, essentially. Right? So that's the issue. The problem is that it's a great achievement in the sense that we as a country are literally forcing people to have health insurance, right? If you don't have it, you're going to get a fine. So it's good in that sense. But it does not, all it provides is access. It does not provide you actual health insurance. There's a difference. It only works if you can afford it. And to this day, the cheapest plan for most families is still about $250 a month, and that's for an individual. If you have an actual family or you have a pre-existing condition, that premium and gold plan that you're going to have to sign up for is going to cost you about $400 a month. Most of us don't have $400 a month to spend on health insurance. It's just a fact. And so while it is a great program, it gives people more opportunity, it's limited by that. It's also limited by the many Republican-controlled states that refuse to expand Medicaid. And by not expanding Medicaid, that means the people that fit the federal definition of essentially people who are impoverished and have limited means are going to be unlikely to actually sign up for the program. But to this day, still, even in states where they have been expanded, again, unless you have the know-how or the time to sit on the phone with the Obamacare representatives for 2 hours to go over your health insurance options, which most of us, A, have not done, and B, are not going to do, because we expect it to be a simple process. We've done all the surveys. We expect to have to sign up for this health care and spend no more than 5-10 minutes doing it. And unfortunately, that's not how it works, and it's going to take several hours of time. And if you are a person of limited means, the only people who are going to be able to get a discounted rate that's lower than about $250 a month are people that either have children or people that qualified for Social Security disability benefits. And those are very limited means of people. So if you're single and poor, sorry, out of luck. You still got to somehow come up with $250 a month. So, you know, it's still, in my opinion, it's a great option. It's better than what we had. It's not what most of us wanted, frankly. But at the end of the day, it's really a program benefiting the middle class, and the middle class is shrinking, so it's benefiting fewer and fewer people.
You could probably argue that on that when President Bush passed the Medicaid Part D, Medicare Part D, there was a donut hole there. And that was a significant problem that he could not overcome legislatively. And the issue here for this is that there needs to be a fix. And that is the place where I think Dr. Pieh suggested we have to get them off of it and push for what we need. We needed a public option. He didn't give it. Congress gave us this elephant type of legislation. And so now we're looking at the problems, but when there are legislative problems, there also should be a legislative fix. And that's what the public has to push. That's our obligation as citizens.
Go ahead.
I'm sorry. I have to teach. I apologize.
I will read again. And I will echo some of the things that have been said and add a little bit of a different twist to it. When I look around my classroom and I talk to college students about the healthcare legislation, typically they don't know, they don't understand, they have not bought in, they have not been impressed. You have to find a way to meet people where they are. If you cannot sell the legislation to them, they're not going to buy in, and it's not going to be successful. You can stand at the mic, you can look good, you can sound good, you can sell it any way you want to, but if you look at the young people around this room, if they're not buying in, if they're not going to invest, it becomes a problem. A second point that you talked about with expanding Medicaid, I'm from Mississippi, and I live, one of the poorest states in the union. I'm one of those people that literally, when people heard about the healthcare legislation, they were super excited. And they immediately start calling me and saying, Barbara, can you help us get signed up? Can you please help us get signed up? Sure, I'm excited. Let's do this. Well, unfortunately, the state of Mississippi has not expanded Medicaid. And so for a lot of those people, they were calling me and I'm putting their information in. We're walking through the process. They may make $16,000 a year. And then at the end of it, they're told that you're going to need to pay $643 a month for your coverage. And so for those individuals, they feel left out. And they feel let down. Now, unfortunately, they don't look at the state level and say, why don't you expand Medicaid so that these people can become eligible? They look at the president and they say, unfortunately, what are you doing? You pushed this policy out there on us, and now you're going to tell me I'm in violation of the law if I can't afford Medicare. So we have to find a way. One, coverage and the way we sell it and the way we tell people about it is everything. Even if you look across this state with Michigan and young people, it is how many of them have actually been motivated to go to the website just to put their information in to see if they're eligible. If we can't find a way to get them, and we can point fingers and say, you lazy people, you sorry voters, doesn't matter. When we get through, we still need them. We still need these young people to sign up because we're depending on their contributions to the system. So until we can meet them where they are, it's going to continue to be a problem until we can look at some of these states like Mississippi, the poorest state of the nation, and get them to expand Medicaid so that some of these people who are hardcore Obama supporters, who bought into the dream that he sells, who believe in him, and then they're disillusioned when they go and they say, I can't afford to pay $600 a month. Do you know how much I make? Maybe I make $1,000. Outside of that, I may bring home less than that. I don't have it, but I want the coverage. What can I do? So we have to find a way. At some point, there has to be a medium to get states to buy in. And outside of that, moving beyond what we can do right now, is we have to get young people to go to the website. And the amazing thing is, for the young people in the room, you may actually be surprised if you go to the website and put your information in at what you would have to pay as a student and how low it is. You may be surprised if you go and look, but if we don't meet people where they are and find a way to sell it, it's going to continue to be a problem. And I think that is a part of the issue of the numbers are much lower than what they originally proposed. No one understands it. Gotta find a way to simplify it. And once again, I can point and say, you lazy people, go and read. You need to learn, you need to understand, because it's not that I don't care. At the end of the day, I need you. So I have to find a way to simplify it, break it down where you get it and you buy in at some point. If not, we're gonna continue this circle, and then it could become what was supposed to be a beautiful thing, could become a nightmare.
I'm on board with my colleagues here. I guess in my own mind now, that as I'm not just now, but as we've been watching what's been going on with Obamacare or the Affordable Care Act, is the question of, you know, how do you meet people where they want? I mean, that's where I am. I just don't know. And is this something that we can place on President Obama? I mean, it's not going away. And so we need to figure out this question, an answer to this question. It's essential.
You have to get the support of the states. The states have to, you have to, and I say this, and being from Mississippi, with those citizens who desperately want the health care, who desperately need it, but the state is not buying in. And the state of Mississippi has a lot of excuses, and their argument, point number one, is there's a Medicaid match, so where do you want us to get this money? What's the priority for you? How do you prioritize? What will you gain if you have a healthy workforce? What will you gain if you have young people who may not be off work because they are healthy, or if you have young people who can invest into the system so some of the seniors or older people who have pre-existing conditions, who are a part of the system, you are now pulling from a larger pool of resources. But if the states aren't buying it, that's problem number one. And then even when the states do buy in, like in the state of Michigan, if the people who are eligible don't buy in, and namely young people is where we've been targeting, I think, the most. I don't know if we launched an effective campaign to try to meet young people where they are and to give them information. And I don't know if it's Facebook, Twitter, or how we push it, but something has to happen as a movement to get these young people in.
You know, one of the things, I don't know how many of you, and I would challenge all of you students, go back, get an Amber News for Sunday. You look at the history of what is happening at the University of Michigan, or what has happened, and you can see the state where we are. Unfortunately, the information is out there. As an academic institution, our role is to pull up, as a teacher, to educate, is to pull up. You go down there, get out there. The universities must take on that. One of the arguments I've always made when we came to the question of integration, the universities took a back seat. We wanted a legal element to play out, just like with the way we're dealing with the whole healthcare thing, because we want the legal element to take care of it. For you and for many of us who are from developing nations, it's amazing for you to look at the World Health statistics, how people are dying. In fact, the latest statistics coming out. And I can see that happening in America. Even though people may say, well, we don't want to, but if you go to emergency room, I don't know if you have been to your emergency room lately, you know, who pays for that? So there are a lot of issues, and this is why, as I said, we have failed the Constitution itself, where people have to be able to negotiate. Even the independence movement, the conflict between the slave owners during the declaration of American independence, they had to give something. Unfortunately, we have leaders today in different political parties who are more interested in the next presidential election than dealing with what the masses really want us to be.
So let's move on. President Obama has announced second-term domestic policy priorities, include a reform of federal laws pertaining to gun control, passage of immigration reforms, a deficit and tax deal with the Republicans, making America more competitive in the world, and improving the status of middle-class America. Given what you've said about the possibility that relations between the White House and the Congress may not improve in the future, what do you see are the chances? What are the chances of the president making good on any of these goals, being able to implement any of these goals? That is, the reform of federal laws pertaining to gun control, passage of immigration reform, etc.
Gun control won't happen. Republicans are not going to allow that. Immigration will, because they need a Latino vote to have any viability of having national election success post-2020. Demographics demonstrate that. The other issues are likely going to make some progress. I do think we'll probably close Guantanamo Bay. I think climate change is going to essentially be, you know, more piecemeal legislation and rhetoric. That helps move the agenda forward, but probably is not going to have any substantive progress in the next Democratic presidency. Everything else, I would say, is likely not going to happen. Not bad Congress. He can make some efforts, executive orders, but you know, if the next president is a Republican, then all those executive orders will be changed on day one.
Well, I would substantially agree with my colleague to my right. I think immigration is the likely candidate, and for the reasons that he's already stated. However, I would like to point out a couple of things. One is that we already have data to suggest that poverty, yes, it is increasing the dissonance between the very rich and the very poor. However,
that there's a marginal difference that can be attributed to Obama's leadership. In other words, it was going to be even worse than it is. So let's not forget that part. I think in our discussion about the health care, we perhaps glossed over a couple of points. One of them is that a person under 26 is eligible to stay on their parents' policy if their parents have it. And Michigan would be an example with a Republican governor who by no means is a liberal or moderate, who did take up Medicaid liberalization. And believe it, he's watching his election chances that are coming around. Remember, one of the first places he went was Detroit. So I think that we cannot abandon hope and change and not do the hard work. The hard work is, when I say we have to do something, I'm not suggesting that the administration cannot do a better job. I'm suggesting that, again, power exceeds to power, the power of the people, the participation of the people. When that midterm primary comes around, if you haven't looked into the candidates and you don't vote, you're going to get whatever happens.
Mm-hmm.
Briefly on the gun control issue, being honest, I don't understand why it was an issue. It was a waste of time. Literally, and I know you guys can throw stones at me when this is over for saying that, but that just was not going to happen. So why waste that time, that energy, and that political capital on that issue? It was not going to go anywhere before it started.
But it had to because of the circus, because of all of the gun terrorism.
Newtown is what it is, right? That's what pushed it behind that. Okay, and it was an issue before. Yeah.
He didn't do anything.
Yeah, okay. He could do it, he used it, he pushed it, and what happened as a result?
See, the reality you have to face is the American Constitution. The Second Amendment or the Fourth Amendment, my right to do this, my right to do that. The question is, where does my own right begin? Because that's been the argument. Again, like, it was clearly, Dr. Perry talked about the function of America within the capitalist system. It's not like in a developing nation, wherein the soldiers from the bush can just come out and overtake it all. Here, it is not a question of a military coup, but here you still have on the sideline people who can finance elections. That we just announced this morning. The Republican Party is now setting up a whole fundraising activity to support the real Republicans for the next election. Where is America? Again, the focus is not being, that's why sometimes we can play the gymnastics, we can play the academic, thing in the classroom, but at the end of the day, until America really begin to take charge, go to the polls, well, you're going to be like Africa. I'm sorry, now you don't want to be like us. We have the resources, but we are under the charge.
Well, okay, let me shift your attention to the foreign policy arena. Earlier on, a panelist talked positively about Obama's refusal to launch a war against Syria. I assume that you've noticed as well that recently, as part of Obama's second term accomplishments, a short-term freeze of portions of Iran's nuclear program was established in exchange for decreased economic sanctions against Iran. Of course, the United States was just one of six world powers that negotiated this agreement with Iran, which was sealed in Geneva on November 24, 2013. The Israeli Prime Minister Bibi Netanyahu took an oppositional stand of describing the accord as a historic mistake. Along with that, the administration has been trying to work out a new Middle East peace agreement. How do you see all this? What's your take on the interim agreement with Iran? What's your take on the effort that the administration is making to work out a peace settlement between Israel and the Palestinians?
I will quickly. I think the president is a foreign policy president, which is amazing. The Democratic Party. I mean, we haven't had a foreign policy success from the president who was a Democrat really ever at this level. But I think there's some negative backlash. I mean, this is the president who has the Nobel Peace Prize. And it's very difficult to be someone who is the champion of peace and also one who is sending people to war. Right, I don't want to be Barack Obama because I don't understand how you manage that conflict. It's a moral one for me. I don't understand how he does it. Because it's complicated. And I think the result of that is that he has had extraordinarily high expectations of him on his foreign policy. And that I think some of us have had perhaps not nearly as much in the domestic arena, but increasingly disillusioned views toward what's happening abroad. There are a few things that have changed significantly in American foreign policy. One, we finally have a president that has argued and said it very clearly that we need a two-state solution between Israel and Palestine. We never had that before. No president ever said that. Very clear. The administration's point of view is two-state solution. How do you do that while also keeping our allegiance to Israel for all the reasons that we've done so historically in the past? It's been the Obama administration's problem because the Israeli government immediately sees that as a slap in the face, right? So it's a catch-22 that they're in on that issue. In terms of Iran, that's huge. The problem is that the Iran issue was oversold by the White House, according to Iranian officials themselves, and that seems to be the case. So instead of just profiling the agreement, decrease use of nuclear proliferation there in Iran as what it was, you know, he tried to oversell it, or someone tried to oversell it in the communications department as more than what it was. And that creates problems, right? And I think that's because the president at that time, as you might recall, was really battling domestic-led issues, primarily around the Affordable Care Act, and this was a reprieve from that 24-hour news cycle. So I think they kind of overzealously explained exactly what that agreement does in Iran. But with that being said, it is a historic achievement. We've never had, as much progress we have had in the Middle East peace process in terms of two-state solutions than we do now. We've never gotten Iran to agree to anything in the last 20, 30 years, other than us giving them weapons under the Reagan administration. So I know it's been very, very difficult. To get them to do anything. The president's response to Mideast issues in Northern Africa, Benghazi, Libya, Tunisia, has been not the best. I think we all know that. But these things happen, and the problem is that America has the expectation that we need to lead globally, right? And I think a broader question to ask ourselves is, do we really have that expectation?
Anyone?
Yes, for sure.
I just would make a sort of a footnote to Dr. Perry's comments, and that is that I think he has had significant gains in the foreign policy arena, and quite frankly, I commend the Nobel people for giving him the Nobel so early, because it in some ways has constrained the typical militaristic American exceptionalism tendency. And so it kind of helps him to negotiate as a peaceful president. But I think also having experienced someone like Jimmy Carter, who came to the table saying, you know, I'm an honorable person, I don't want to kill, I don't want to lie, I don't want to cheat. Barack Obama didn't say that. And he has done some of it. If a president doesn't, he's not going to be an effective president. Witness Jimmy Carter. If the other countries think, well, somehow or another, you're so lovely and sweet, we can just invade and, you know, imprison your people.
So back to that, I want to just circle back around to say that with Syria, he came out militaristically, but he did a, I think, very admirable job of phasing that with his allies, who normally are his enemies in Congress, and then getting Syria and Russia to back that down. But you can't do it if you start off the conversation saying, I'm willing to concede.
Okay. Any additional comments on that?
I believe the discussion of foreign policy to my state colleagues.
I see. Okay. All right. At this point, I will invite my colleague, Professor Roland Woods, to conduct the part of the discussion and will involve questions from the audience. So those of you who have been waiting to ask questions, this is your opportunity.
Thank you to everyone, and we do thank you. Let's give a round of applause right now to the panel. This is perhaps the most important part of the afternoon because we'd like for you now to come forward, offer your observations, questions, as you will. So if you will, we do have a mic here, so I'd encourage you to come forward now. Please do just if you'll identify yourself and give your question, your comment, however you will.
Sorry. My name is Joelle Lilo. I'm a senior here at Eastern. I'm a major from the Myers English Linguistics. I'm writing an article for the Eastern Network on the discussion today. One of the questions I asked a few of the people I interviewed is how do you all feel about, during the State of the Union, he addressed the minimum wage raising it to $10.10. What do you think that effect will have on the country
in short term? Well, he did not say, he said that we should raise the minimum wage to 10. That 10 was a reference to what he's doing in the federal, the executive order in terms of directing federal contractors to have to be paid at that minimum wage. I mean, in some cases, it's too little too late, right? I mean, you should have done this a long time ago. I mean, that's one argument that, you know, I'm not a Fox News lover, full disclosure, but, you know, that's one argument that they did very well in the post the State of the Union analysis. You know, he's had this executive power since January 20th, 6 years ago. So, you know, why has he not done this, you know, then? And I guess one answer to why has he only done this now? And I guess one answer to that is, well, if you believe his approach to governing, and that being that he wants a conciliatory relationship, ideally he's trying to create this United States of America, he's trying to create a whole new Washington culture, well, clearly that hasn't really been very successful, right? But at least it's an aspiration. And I think he spent just too much time believing that he could actually be successful in working with the party that, particularly post the last midterm, has no desire to work with them directly, largely because of their extreme right caucus of the Tea Party. Just for you students in the room, perhaps for you others, Tea Party is not an actual party. It's not actual one entity. It's multiple entities of conservatism within the Republican Party, and they happen to call themselves Tea Party. And that is what that's what's happened. So. But I will say this, you know, a lot of us, you know, I just came from the National Conference on LGBT Equality, and a lot of those advocates were arguing that, you know, State of the Union should have addressed more about particular groups of marginalized issues for people that have, you know, particular diseases, people from other communities, and that it didn't do that. Well, the reference to the minimum wage issue actually does, because if you are lifting up the least of us, given our economic inferiority of other subgroups in society, then you are in fact attending indirectly though, you're attending to the needs of the many people who might be disadvantaged or marginalized. And so, but he needs to go further than just doing it with federal contractors. But the problem is that in order for that to happen and then the actual minimum wage itself go up to 10, which by the way would still be low, It would have to happen through Congress, and I just don't see Congress doing that.
Yes, please.
I want to know, I too want to understand some of the long-term effects and the short-term effects. If you guys could speak to that, I would, or answer the question with regards to that, I would agree. I don't know the answer. I don't have an answer on some of the short-term.
Is that just to clarify your question, would that be the shorter term, long-term effects of minimum wage or the president's moving out on his own to do it by executive order?
The raising of the minimum wage.
Okay, thank you.
If I can add just a few comments to that, I guess the larger question is what percentage of the population actually earns or work for minimum wage in a country today? And it's relatively small. The bigger issue or the long-term issue becomes how does this impact pay or salary across the board? So when it comes to negotiating contracts or with deans or things of that nature, if the minimum wage has risen, what impact will that have on what they will ask for their workers in the future? And also with, I guess, things that we understand, if the minimum wage is going to go up, then what happens to everything that we purchase or prices around us? Do we still get a break? Typically, we're gonna also watch those prices increase or creep up over time. So if you are a poor person and you're working for minimum wage, you say, it's a great day. I have more money coming into my household. How, unfortunately, as the market changes, that minimum wage is not going to buy you a whole lot more over time or in the long term.
To answer your question, 60% of all wage and salary workers get minimum wage.
Wow, didn't know it was that high.
60%.
Well, 59.
We're also talking about the income disparity. And with that kind of figure, you can just think about that if you can lift folks up to a little bit at the very end of the economic spectrum, so they at least get some food and shelter. I personally don't see why we can't afford it. How silly is it? Let's how about get one less B-53 or nuclear silo or something? I don't. See that as a hindrance, and business is booming now. We may not feel it because we're not all at that level, but the Barneys and all the big stores are going big because the people at the top are doing really well. How about if they just have 1% less or even 0.5% less on the profit margin?
Thank you,
Patty.
I look at it more the whole issue as a moral issue. I believe you cannot legislate morality. And if you listen to the president's speech, he was appealing to individual groups like the guy from Minnesota who came down with his worker. He raised the morale of the person. As a society, I think we have to start. Let's be realistic. I enjoyed the football game on Saturday night, but for 2.5 hours, this guy in the winners made $79,000 or $80,000. How many people in this room or here in New Campus make that much per year? You look at football players or basketball players or baseball players, we give them $180 million contracts. To me, most of these things are not legislative issues. These are all moral issues. And as a society, we have to look at it. And that's why I always want to call people. We need to go back and look at what the man said last week. Instead, what are they? Some of the Republicans calling him a lawless president. Let's be realistic.
Thank you. And we're going to continue with our questions. As we receive or field the questions panel, we'll take a couple of responses to be able to accommodate all of our questions. Thank you.
My name is James. I graduated from high school in December. I guess my biggest question is, what policy of Obama during this time period that he's been there do you disagree because I feel this is important to me, and personally I feel like there should be some Black Republicans on the panel as well. I'm not sure if there is or whatever. Because if you're so in love, I'm not saying that you are, I appreciate everything that you're saying. If you're so in love with all his policies as one group, and then you have another group over here who not so in love with his policies, then you're asking both groups to come together and find a middle ground. I don't see that. I don't see personally how to make that possible. So you, I love my mother, but we have disagreements. We don't agree on everything. So yes, I agree that, you know, a lot of his policies are correct, but I challenge you now to speak about the policies that you would be willing to meet middle ground with the Republicans and say, well, maybe not on this one, and maybe we can come up with a better agreement together.
Let's see if we can do this one like this. If those, if maybe we can just go down the line here, or how we would do it, and just identify one major policy with which you disagree, and without a lot of elaboration, if you would. So we'll just, however you will.
The president's funding on HIV and AIDS research in the United States and abroad has been dismally low compared to his Republican predecessor, and he should be embarrassed.
Thank you.
I guess I would say not having the single payer and the prescription drugs competitive within the health care.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
That's very easy for me. That's a very good question. It raises a lot, and I will be very frank, I promise. A lot of times, I think, and I've watched panels, and I find it interesting when you have African Americans on the panel, and you're correct, is everybody talks about what an awesome, great, wonderful job the president has done. And we do need to be critical of maybe some of the things that he hasn't done so well. I'm an education policy person, and yeah, I have major issues with some of the things that he's done with education policy. I don't agree. I don't agree with the plan. I'm a product of the public school system. I'm an advocate for the public school system, and I wish there were more reforms that targeted that system instead of pulling money away from that system and shifting it out and doing market strategies. Just not a fan of it. On the flip side, we don't talk about it. We haven't talked about drug policy. And I think it's a beautiful thing if you have a president who's willing to step away from that Reagan approach of, if you have a drug problem, you are, I guess, a criminal. If you're a criminal element, you're a bad person. And you take a different approach of, let's examine these people and see what the issue is. Maybe there is an addiction or a problem that can be addressed. So now we don't have to treat people who are sentenced for crack and cocaine very differently. So
actually, he has done that with
crack. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that that's one of the things that he's done well.
Right.
And that doesn't get him a lot of attention. So I support that and I advocate that, but when it comes to education policy, we differ. And I spend a lot of time doing research, so our approach is just different on the strategy of how you make it better.
Thank you, Dr. Johnson.
I think I would struggle to say one policy that I have an issue with. What's stronger for me in terms of having an issue is the whole negotiation with his insistence on really trying to work with people really have no care for him and are not interested in negotiating with him. It's very frustrating to me to see that the nation is further right to the right. For him to negotiate, you're still in the right side of things if you already start on the right. Does that make sense? Not in the middle. And that's very frustrating for me, his style in negotiating.
Thank you. Dr. Pieh. No, that.
What? Actually,
if there are none, you don't have to.
No, I don't have anything that at least I focus on. I mean, it's like we would be on some foreign policy when it comes to policies affecting Africa. But I'm looking at what you present. The question you raised is, again, for me, a rhetorical question. What sort of policy are we going to need in ensuring even this whole question of equal? Again, if you go back and you look on the web page, you look at the work bill that was sent out, just sit back in the last 2 weeks in Detroit, you know how many water things are being built here in Detroit. We know the infrastructure is so poor, there is gas, We saw what happened in Minneapolis. Those were policies that were that was once supported by the other one. But again, the question here, and he had the same question you raised, a man called Schatzel made the same question. Well, I am not a Republican, I'm not a Democrat. I am looking at what is best for America in the future. And this idea that if I see that we're going to have a black Republican or a white Republican, what is material to me is not essential. But what is important for America as a nation?
Thank you, Patrick. We're going on. Please.
Hi, my name is Kyle. I'm a master's in history student here at Eastern. My question has to do, we talked a lot about the midterm elections and how important those are. I think that even though a lot of us will say that the Republican Party does a bad job at a lot of things, they do have a really good job at pandering people to vote against their own interests. And I just feel like, you know, how does President Obama and the rest of the Democratic candidates in 2014 kind of changes so they can get more people instead of reacting in a paranoid kind of way that some stupid poor white people do. I'm from a community of all stupid poor white people, so is there any way that they can kind of change their message into how they kind of pander to a larger voting base that especially vote in digital elections?
Panel, we have that question, two others, and about 4.5 minutes. So if I could just take one response to that, that if you
would. I would say two things. Pass the minimum wage, campaign for that, and campaigning on immigration, because those are some voters that are often not at the polls for the midterm election.
I would add campaign on the Supreme Court, too. We don't have justices that are in the interest of whatever your values are, then, you know, it's going to change.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
How you doing? I'm Brian. I'm a student here. I come from a very diverse background. So if I, the question I ask, I'm not a racist, so it's an honest question. Now, the Affordable Care Act, if you recall, way back when it was introduced, it was supposed to be transparent. It was majority passed through by the Senate, that was Democrat. The Republicans didn't have anything to say about this law. It was over 2,000-page law. It was not debated. It was not sold as a tax at the time. So do you think because of the beginning, the formation of this massive law, that it gave a bad taste in the Republicans, the Congress, it gave a bad taste from the beginning of formation because there was no debate. And as Nancy Pelosi said, don't worry about it, we'll read it later. You think all of this has led to the gridlock that we are experiencing today?
I think your question, your facts are wrong.
What facts?
There was debate in Congress. There's debate on both sides of the House and the Senate in committees.
They were not knocked out. They were knocked out.
There was not debate on the floor.
Okay.
And they used that as a procedural move, which, by the way, both parties have done repeatedly. We didn't debate the Patriot Act, which is, we never debated that.
We're not talking about that. We're talking about the Affordable Care
Act. Both parties do it. And they did it in the rule structure, and so what happened was that there was no debate on the floor. There was debate in the respective committees where people, even the public, can go to those committees and debate and testify, etc. It did not go on the floor. It was a procedural move that both parties have used whenever they're in power. Certain conservative outlets just framed it in that particular way.
Let's hear from Betty on this, and then let me also point out that we'll get our last question, but we'll try to conclude very shortly here. Hopefully there will be time for those of you who yet have interaction that you'd like to have with our panelists to do that. Betty.
Okay, well, there was a bipartisan committee that helped to formulate the original Act and many of the provisions of that bipartisan committee, the Republican caucus did not agree to once it was introduced from the committee as legislation to go forward. So there was input.
Thank you. And our last question, sir. Thank you.
My name is Stephen Braddon. I'm an anthropology major here. And I was just wondering your thoughts with America sort of fighting a constant war on drugs and basic modern day slavery, much of that coming into the country through the maritime system. What do you think about Obama's desire to close down Guantanamo Bay Navy Base?
I mean, I think it's a moral, ethical desire. I believe him when he says it's important. And by the way, there's a lot of bipartisan support for this, not only in Congress, but throughout the country of public opinion. Majority of Americans want it closed. Majority of Republicans want it closed. Majority of Democrats want it closed. The issue is it's very complicated. You have international terrorists, at least as they've been accused and have been convicted there. And the issue is about placement. Nobody's gonna want them in their backyard. And that's the problem. There have been a few states that have voluntarily welcomed them, and then their citizens go out and do petition drives saying, absolutely not. We don't want these people in our backyard. So the issue, the really one of the main issues is not the closing of it. That's actually fairly easy, and most people agree with that. The issue is, where do you put these people? Because one benefit about Guantanamo Bay is that people feel detached from it. But if Guantanamo Bay is now, in Novi, the new, right, in Traverse City, or the new penitentiary up there, people are closer there, and for Americans to just feel as though we're living closer to those types of people who we consider to be terrorists and bad for us, even if they're in the maximum security, as the president has argued would be the case, it makes people uncomfortable.
Panelists, any closing comments for the hour, 15 seconds?
I would like a quick closing comment. I guess this panel has been productive today, but I think we do you a disservice if we don't tell you, like Obama, don't like Obama. I challenge you to go to the website and look at the healthcare exchange just to see what's there for you. Put your information in and see if it works for you. And if you already have healthcare, challenge a friend to do it. The next best thing that I can tell you as a citizen of Michigan now, please pay attention to what's going on with the election and the upcoming elections, and listen to what your gubernatorial candidates have to say to you. If we look around the state, what's happening to us economically is uber important. If we can impress nothing else upon you today as Southern Political Science Department, please register to vote, and please pay attention to what these people are saying and go out and vote.
Anyone else? Thank you very much.
I just wanted to say, as Dr. Perry pointed out, he has a book. I have a book. It's right over there. I'm happy to find it.
Thank you, Patrick.
Again, in closing, what at least what I have and I will continue to do is for us to begin to understand that America is not an island. America must be viewed within the global context. Until we really recognize that there are issues we go to, the last thing will be for people to understand that laws are made. If you side and pass on the war history for politicians to come together and fix those laws as opposed to resulting in sharing of each other, I think that's the civility we have failed to endure.
Thank you. Probably like it to Dr. Johnson.
Thank you for having me. I'm going to continue the conversation with you and everybody else. I'd like to hear more from the audience, I guess.
Thank you.
My quick thank you as well. I will echo what Dr. Patrick said on social sciences. We have to all be involved in action. If you're not registered to vote, register to vote. Need to help people. If you have a car, help people get to the polls. If you need to take the day off, ask for that ahead of time. If you don't know about the issues, frankly, that's your fault. You
can go to a public library, you can go to the union here, you have access to the information, get it so that you are an informed voter. And then vote. Because that's how you make change in American politics. It's not the best system, but that's the system we've got down. So if you like it, vote. If you don't like it, vote.